Welcome viewers, we continue our discussion on the instruction set, the vocabulary of the machine. Let us try to understand what are the different parameters one has to look at whenever you design an instruction set. When you have to design an instruction set, you have to consider several parameters, and let us see what are the parameters involved. First one, as you have seen, inside the CPU you have got one arithmetic and logic unit. So you have to understand, you have to know what are the operations supported by the ALU. In other words, you have to know the instruction report tier that has to be provided by the processor. That is the first information you should have to design an instruction set. Then you have to know the various data types, the data types the processor has to support. We have already discussed at length the data types supported by microprocessors, particularly the 8085. We have seen that 8085 supports 8-bit 2's complement integer number and BCD numbers in packed form in a limited way. Then you have to consider what are the different formats that will be used in the by the instructions. So the instruction format also plays an important role, and we have seen what are the different instruction formats supported by 8085 microprocessor. And finally, we have to see what are the registers available, and we have discussed the different types of registers provided in microprocessors, particularly in 8085. What are the registers available, we have discussed in details. And lastly, you have to know the addressing modes that is provided by a particular microprocessor. And we have discussed at length the different addressing modes provided by different microprocessors, and particularly the addressing modes provided by 8085, inherent, immediate, direct, register, indirect, and stack. We have discussed all these things in details. Now we are in a position to introduce to you the instruction set of a microprocessor, and we shall introduce to you the instruction sets, different types, with example of 8085. First, we focus our discussion attention to classification of instructions. The instructions can be broadly classified into five different types. What are the five different types? First one is data movement instructions. With the help of these data movement instructions, the data is moved between registers, from register to memory, memory to register, memory to IO, IO to registers, and so on. So data movement instructions are necessary, and we shall discuss in details what are the different types of data movement instructions supported by 8085. Then the second category of instructions are known as data manipulation instructions. The data manipulation instructions will provide you information about what are the operations the ALU can perform. Essentially, this data manipulation is performed by the ALU. So it depends on the capability of the ALU that is provided inside the processor and the various types of data manipulations that can be performed is represented by data manipulation instructions. Then there is third category, which are known as program manipulation instructions. With the help of these program manipulation instructions, you can change the flow of the instruction. Later on you will see that instead of writing a program instructions one after the other, you have to move, you have to jump, and so on. There will be interrupts, there will be subroutine calls, and so on. The instructions which with the help of which you can do this kind of change in the flow of the program, execution flow of the program, is known as program manipulation instructions. Then there are some instructions with the help of which you can change the status of the processor, which are known as status manipulation instructions. With the help of whenever you execute status manipulation instructions, you will see no movement of data take place, no manipulation of data take place, no change in the flow of the program take place, but some flag bits, some register contents are altered, which changes the status of the processor. Later on we shall discuss in detail the different types of status manipulation instructions that you require. Finally, there are some instructions which cannot fall within any of these categories. And as you know, whenever we cannot categorize something, we give a name called miscellaneous. So there will be some miscellaneous instructions. So with the help of this, there are some miscellaneous instructions, and we shall see which are provided to perform some important functions, particularly for debugging and other operations. We shall discuss in detail the miscellaneous instructions as well. So we start with the data movement category. The data movement instructions again has got several types. The first one and the most useful is between data movement between two registers. We have seen inside the processor there are a number of registers provided. For example, we shall take example from 8085. We have seen that 8085 has got, apart from the accumulator, it has got several registers like B, C, D, E, H, L. These are all general purpose registers. So you should be able to interchange data between these registers, transfer from one register to another register. That can be done with the help of this instruction. So move, the name is, the mnemonic of that instruction is move R1 comma R2. What are you doing here? You are transferring the content of R2 to R1. And inside the instruction, the source register is referred by these three bits, destination register is referred by these three bits, and these two bit specifies that this is a move instruction. And obviously the register names are to be coded here in terms of a bit sequence, and it is coded in this manner, say destination register or it may be source register. 111 corresponds to register A, 000 is B, 001 is C, 010 is D, 011 is E, 100 is H, 101 is L. So you can see here there are seven registers, so three bits are sufficient to give a code to any one of these registers. That means whenever you are transferring from say accumulator to a register, another register, then it can be here say accumulator it will be 111, and you are transferring to B it will be 000. That means if you are transferring from say accumulator to a register B, it will be, the code will be 01000111 and so on. Obviously, whenever you use this particular instruction, as you can see here, it can be represented by a single byte, and as a result it will occupy minimum area in the computer's memory, and execution time is also very small. Number of cycles needed is just one, and the number of states needed is just four. That means each cycle is represented by a state. You may recall we discussed the execution of different instructions. Fetch cycle. Say this is the timing diagram for 8085 microprocessor for fetching an instruction. And we have seen that it is completed in four cycles. In four cycles, the entire thing is being completed, four clock cycles, and it is called one machine cycle. And since it has got, it is requiring four clock cycles, it has got four states. So you are fetching the instruction in three clock cycles, then executing it in the fourth clock cycle. The reason for that is all the data is available inside the processor in this particular case. So you are able to execute in the fourth clock cycle. Now, this type of instructions are very common and widely used. The second type of data movement instruction is immediate data. Immediate operand to a particular register. And the mnemonic of that instruction is MVI, R, comma, and the data. The data has to be, in this particular case, is of 8 bit. The opcode is 00, then the destination register address, depending on to which register you are shifting, and 110. So inside the opcode itself, as you can see, the destination address register is embedded, and of course you have to provide the immediate data that has to be transferred to the designated register. In this particular case, you will require two cycles. Why you will require two cycles? Why you will require two cycles? Because the first cycle will be a instruction fetch cycle like this, requiring four clock cycles, and the second cycle will be a read cycle involving three clock cycles or three states. So this is one read cycle. So you will require one read cycle and an instruction fetch cycle like this. So these two will make 1 plus 1, 2, and number of clock cycles or states required will be 7, 4 plus 3 in this particular case. Now, instead of transferring data to a particular register, you can simultaneously transfer to two registers, or you can transfer to register pair. So this is R, this is P, and this is your data. This is the mnemonic of the instruction, and the instruction format for 8085 for this type of instruction is like this. Opcode is 00. Then you are using 2 bit to designate, to specify the register pair, and here you have got 0001. And this is your lower lower order byte. And here it will be higher order byte. As per the Little Endian convention. And in this case, what will be the number of cycles involved? If you calculate, if you try to find out what is the number of clock cycle, number of machine cycles that will be required and how many states you will require. First of all, you will require an opcode fetch cycle. And you have to read these two bytes, one read cycle followed by another read cycle. So total number of machine cycles that will be required is 3, and number of states that will be required to execute the instruction will be 4 plus 3 plus 3, so that will be 10. You will require 10 states or 10 clock cycles to execute this instruction. So here we have seen how you can transfer the data between two registers, or you can transfer immediate data to either a single register or a pair of registers for 8085 microprocessor. Obviously, similar instructions are available in other microprocessors. Then the third type of data movement instruction is between a register. Between a register and a memory location. So in this case, whenever you are transferring data from a register to a memory location, you can do it in a variety of ways. But if you want that the instruction size should be small, it should be just of 1 byte like this, then you can use a special addressing mode, or the addressing mode which is supported by 8085, that is your indirect addressing. I have already discussed about that indirect addressing mode. So indirect addressing mode will be used here. So in this particular case, DDD stands for the register, and the mnemonic that will be used is move R, comma M. So memory to a register. Where from the address of the memory will come? Here we'll be using register addressing. Register indirect addressing. How? One of the register is implicitly assumed as the source of the indirect address. Which register? The HL register pair. So HL register pair, let me write it more clearly, HL register pair will transfer data content of the, that means the address specified by the HL register pair. There you will get your operand, and data will be transferred to the designated register, DDD. The DDD, that means the destination register address, is as per this particular code. And the total number of clock cycles that will evolve in this particular case is how many? Can you guess? Here you will require one machine cycle, or rather instruction fetch cycle, plus another fetch cycle to read from that memory location pointed by this HL register pair. So you will require read one instruction fetch cycle, that is one, plus one read cycle. So total number of machine cycles will be 2, and total number of states that you will require in this particular case will be 4 plus 3, 7. Now you can use not only from memory to register, you can also use the same type of addressing mode for transfer of data from a register to a memory location. In this particular case, that content of a register is transferred to a memory location specified, or the address is provided in that HL register pair, and the instruction format is like this: 0 1 1 1 0. And as you know, the least significant 3 bits are used to specify the register source register address. Here also the total number of cycles that you will require will be equal to 2, one instruction fetch cycle followed by one read cycle. Here you will require one instruction fetch cycle like this, instruction fetch cycle requiring 4 clock cycles followed by one write cycle. So this is your write, and write cycle is also of 3 clock cycles. So together you will require total number of states that will be required is 4 plus 3, that is 7. Now, instead of using this register indirect addressing, you can also use direct addressing. So in case of direct addressing, the instruction is the mnemonic is LDA, and then you have to provide the address, and you are transferring, in this particular case you are transferring directly only to the accumulator. You are not transferring to any register but only to the accumulator, and byte 3 and byte 2 of the instruction is providing you the address. So here it will be, opcode will be like this: 0 1 1 1 1 0 1 0, and the address will be specified in the 2 bytes, byte 2 and byte 3. So here is your address. Obviously the execution for this instruction will require several cycles. First of all, to fetch this opcode you will require one instruction fetch cycle, plus to read this lower order byte of address you will require another read cycle, to read this higher order byte you will require another read cycle, then you have to read from the address specified here, so another machine cycle. So altogether you will require 4 machine cycles, and total number of states that will be required is 13. 4 plus 9, 4 plus 9 is 13. Similarly, you have store accumulator address. This is the code transfer, this is the instruction for transferring data from, for loading data into a memory location from the accumulator. And the instruction format is somewhat similar. You will require 3 bytes. The code is 0 0 1 1 0 0 1 0, and this is your address. This is your address requiring 2 bytes, and in a similar manner you can say that total number of cycles required will be 4, and total number of states that you will require will be 13. Now you have some special type of data movement instructions like load HL register pair directly, then you provide the address. That means from a memory location, from 2 consecutive memory locations, you will be loading the HL register pair directly. This is one instruction. Similarly, you can store HL register pair using direct addressing, and the mnemonic is ADDR, SHLD ADDR. You can also load a register pair, you can use a register pair. In this case, what you are doing, you are loading the accumulator, and the register pair is providing you the indirect address. Similarly, you can store register pair RP is the register pair is providing you the address from the accumulator. Here the register pairs are also coded just like registers. This is your register pair, and here is the code. 00 is for the BC register pair, 01 is for DE register pair, then 10 is for HL register pair, 11 is for stack pointer. So you can use any one of the register pair as the to provide the source address, and you can use register indirect addressing to load the accumulator or store the data in the accumulator to MMI location. And some useful instruction like exchange is also provided. Exchange instruction where you can swap the content of two registers pairs. For example, the content of D register pair is getting interchange with the HL register pair. This type of instructions are sometimes required whenever you write a program. So these are useful in some cases. And finally, the final type of data movement instruction is between. Between accumulator and IO location. Later on we shall discuss in little more detail, particularly when we shall be discussing about the interfacing of IO devices, that IO devices can be mapped on the memory address space, or IO devices can be mapped on separate exclusive address space. So whenever IO devices are mapped on exclusive address space, in such a case you will require explicit instruction for transferring from IO devices to one of the registers. In this case it is the accumulator. So this is what is being done here. And there are two special instructions are provided, where in and out, and this port stands for the port address. And obviously, in this case, the code will be 112 of 2 byte, 1101, 1011, and here is your port address. Similarly, for out, it will be 1110, 0011, and the total number of cycles required will be 3, and total number of states required will be 10. So same is true here. Port, this is the instruction format of 2 bytes, and total number of state cycles will be 3, and total number of states required will be 10. Now at this point I would like to draw your attention to one important aspect. We have seen the microprocessor is provided with a single bus. So on that single bus, the CPU can generate an address. That address can correspond to either a memory location or a IO location. So at a time you can transfer data from IO to the CPU or memory to the CPU. You cannot directly transfer from any memory location to a IO location, because simultaneously you cannot generate the address of memory as well as IO, because of the single bus. That's why whenever you have to transfer data from IO to a memory location, you have to do it in two steps, from IO to accumulator and from accumulator to that memory location, or from memory to the accumulator and then accumulator to the memory IO location. So you have to use these two steps. But whenever you have to transfer a large block of data, then this particular process involves lot of time. So we have to overcome this particular mechanism, and for that purpose a special addressing mode, a special technique known as DMA mode of data transfer, direct memory address mode of data transfer, can be used. Later on we shall discuss it in more details. So these are all about the data movement instructions. And you have another category, as I told, data manipulation instructions. And as I told, it is solely decided by the capability of the ALU. And the first type of instructions are arithmetic. Arithmetic instructions. And you know, the number of arithmetic instructions that is provided will depend on the type of arithmetic operations supported by the ALU. It can be addition, subtraction, multiplication, division, and so on. But as we have discussed, for 8085, the ALU is capable of performing only addition and subtraction, and that too on only 8-bit data. So it is restricted, but we shall discuss for 8085 only. And obviously for other processors, you may have multiplication, division, and so on. Here, the addition operation is possible in several ways. For example, one possibility is add R. What you are doing here, you are adding the content of the accumulator. As I said, always one operand will come from the accumulator. Content of the accumulator is added with the content of a particular register. And that register address will be specified the way we have done for the way we have specified in by these codes. This is one type of instruction provided for adding. Then it can be add M. You can directly add the content of a memory location with that of the accumulator, and result will be available in the accumulator. And here that memory address is specified with the help of that register indirect addressing, and HL register pair holds the address of the memory location. You can also perform addition with some immediate data. And the mnemonic for that code, ADI data. I am not giving the details of the codes, that's not necessary. So addition with a register content, addition with a memory location, addition with immediate data. These are the three types of addition instructions available. Apart from that, you can do add with carry. You know, the processor has got a carry flag bit. Sometimes whenever you are doing chain calculations, the carry generated from the first step has to be added with the, in the second step. To facilitate that, this add with carry instruction is available. That too can be done with the register content, add with carry with a memory location, add with carry with an immediate data. So these are all supported by 8085. Similarly, you have got subtraction, and all these varieties available for addition are also available for subtraction. Subtraction with a register content, I mean accumulator is subtracted from, the register value is subtracted from the accumulator content. Result is available in the accumulator. Subtraction with a content of a memory location. Subtraction with that subtraction immediate, obviously data has to be specified. Here also data has to be specified. Then subtraction with borrow with a register, subtraction with borrow and with a register, subtraction with borrow with a memory location, subtraction with borrow with immediate data. So these are the two basic instructions available with 8085. Apart from that, you have got increment. You can increment a register content. You can increment a memory location. And as you can see here, whenever you are using memory location, always you are using that register indirect. Register indirect addressing. And similarly, you have DCR, decrement instruction. In decrement instruction, you can perform decrement with a register, decrement from register content, decrement from a content of a memory location. You can also perform the that decrement of a register pair. Increment of a register pair, decrement of a register pair, and you can perform the addition register pair to HL. That means you can add the content of the register pair, one at a time, H and L, HL, you are adding the content of the HL register pair with some other, say RH and RL, another register pair, say BC, DE, you can add, or HL itself, then you can transfer the content to the HL register pair. So these are the data manipulation instructions available in belonging to the arithmetic group. Addition, subtraction, increment, decrement, and increment in a variety of ways, and addition of the that register pair. I mean, you are doing some kind of double addition, addition of H and L, two register contents simultaneously. Then by the name ALU, we mean arithmetic and logical instructions, arithmetic and logic unit. So the ALU can perform logical operations, and you can have AND logical operation, exclusive OR, these are very common, OR. These are the three basic logical operations are performed. And for example, you are performing on two operands A and B, then depending on the values of these three registers, the result for AND will be 0, 0, 0. This is the truth table for AND. For exclusive OR, as you know, it will be 1, 0, 1, 1, 0. For OR, it will be 0, 1, 1, 1. And obviously, whenever you are performing logical instructions, one operand will be always the accumulator. The second operand can be a register. Second operand can be a memory location. The second operand can be an immediate data that has to be provided as part of the instruction. So for addition, as you can see here, there are three possibilities: addition with a register, addition with a memory location, addition with a immediate data. Similarly, you can perform exclusive OR, XRA, with a register, exclusive operation, one operand is in the accumulator, another in register, here XRA memory location, or XRA exclusive OR with some immediate data. Similarly, for OR with a register, or with a memory location, or with immediate data. And apart from AND, exclusive OR, another important logical operation is compare. You can compare to data. One can be, obviously, one will be in the accumulator, another one can be in a register, or it can be in a memory location, or it can be some immediate data. This type of comparison instructions are very useful. Later on, we'll see, whenever you have to take some decision, you have to compare two data, one in the accumulator, another may be coming from a register or a memory location or immediate data, and based on that outcome, some of the flag bits will change and you can take decision, and these will be used in program manipulation instructions. So then you have got that complement. Complement is essentially you are complementing the accumulator and storing the result in the accumulator itself. So it is essentially the bit by bit complement of each bit, and it is stored in the accumulator. Then the apart from these AND OR exclusive OR compare and complement, you have got rotate instructions. You can perform rotation, rotate or shift in two ways: rotate left involving carry, not with carry, without carry, and another can be, so how, what is done, say this is the content of, you can perform this only on the content of the accumulator. So accumulator 0th bit, least significant bit, and this is the most significant bit, and you have the other bits here. So these are the 7 bits. Whenever you perform rotate, you are rotating left, so the content of A0 comes to A1, A1 comes to A2, content of A1 comes to A2, and A7 goes to A0, as well as it is also transferred to the carry flag bit. It also goes to the carry flag bit. So in this way, you can perform rotate. Rotate left without carry. And here it is rotate right without carry. You are doing the same thing, but in the right direction. Instead of left, you will be shifting in this direction. So the content of S1, S7 will go to A6. A6 content of A6 will go to A5. In this way, A0 will be transferred to A7, and the content of A0 will also come to CY. Now you can do also rotate operation with carry. Those two are without carry. The code for that is RAL, and in this case the rotation takes place with carry flag bit, with the carry flag bit in the loop. As you can see here, you are doing rotation in this manner. That means content of A7 goes to CY, the content of CY goes to A0, content of A0 goes to A1, content of A1 goes to A2, and so on. This is rotate left with carry. And you have also rotate right with carry, RAR is the mnemonic. And here you are performing rotate right with carry. So it will be like this: content of A0 comes to CY, content of CY carry flag bit goes to A7, A7 goes to A6, and so on. So these are the rotate or shift operations provided in 8085. I am not giving you the opcode formats, but these are all single byte instructions, and will require 4 clock cycles. And as you can see, in this case only the carry flag bit will be affected, and in these operations AND OR exclusive OR, not only carry flag bit, all the flag bits will be affected. And in fact, in all these arithmetic operations also, all the flag bits like carry, then your that sign, parity, all will be affected. Then apart from this logical instructions, you have a special type of instruction provided so that you can support the BCD formal limit, BCD data manipulation in a limited way. So this DAA is essentially a special instruction. DAA stands for Decimal Adjust Accumulator, and I have already mentioned about this DAA. Now let us see how exactly the DAA helps you to perform manipulation of the BCD data. Suppose in the accumulator you have got 37, the content of the accumulator is equal to 37, it is in BCD. So 37 will be 0 0 1 1 0 1 1 1 37. Now you want to add 15, that is also in BCD. So this is your 15, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, and 5, 0, 1, 0, 1. Now, inside the processor, the ALU that you have got will not perform BCD addition, because the adder is not a BCD adder. It is a 2's complement adder. So it will do that conventional addition. It will perform, indeed it will perform addition if you execute addition. This data can be in a register or a memory location, or it can be immediate data. Anyway you can do, in any form you can use this second operand. So whenever you perform the bit by bit and the addition of these two numbers by using binary adder, what you will get? 110 carry, 110 carry, 111, then it is 1. Here it will be 110 110 0 1 0. Okay, 0 1 1 0 1 0 0 1 0 0 0. So that is what you get after performing addition. So this is essentially 4C in hex. So you can see this is not a BCD data. In it should be 52. So to get this BCD data, you have to execute DAA instruction. Now if you execute, this is in the accumulator, and whenever you execute DAA instruction, what it does, it performs, this is in the accumulator. The rule is, if any one of the nibble, this 4 bit or this 4 bit is more than 6, or if there is carry, so if there is carry, that there is auxiliary carry coming out, or if this is more than 9, then 6 is added. That is the situation for this nibble. But here it is less than 9, and also there is no carry from here. So the DAA instruction does not add 6 but adds 0. And after performing this addition, you get 0, 1, 0, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0. So this is your 5 and 2. So you have got 52 at BCD data. So you see, by using DAA, you are originally having 2 BCD data stored in the accumulator and in another register or a memory location in packed form. Then you performed addition in binary, then you execute the DAA instruction and you get the BCD data. So you can see you are able to perform BCD addition. Obviously, although the instruction will be of only 1 byte, but the total number of cycles involved will be in only, all these things can be done in clock cycle, 4 clock cycles. Now let me illustrate this with another example. Suppose you are adding 85 with 68. What will be the result? 153. These are all in BCD. So originally 85 is stored 100. Then 5 is 0101, 6 is 0116, 8 is 1000. Then if you add by using binary adder, which is provided inside the 8085 microprocessor, you will get 10110111. Obviously, this is, as you can see, more than 9, this is also more than 9. So you have to, the DAA instruction will add 6 to this as well as 6 to this. Then you get 0, 1, 1, it will be 1, then there is a carry 0, 1. So what you get, and obviously this will, there is an overflow, that is, there is a carry, this is your carry, this will be stored in the carry flag bit. And what you are getting in the carry flag bit 1, this is 5 and this is 3. So you are getting 1 in the carry flag bit, 5, 3 in BCD. So you can see here, you are able to perform the BCD of a BCD addition using the binary adder. And this special instruction, which is known as decimal adjust accumulator, is provided as part of the instruction. So to summarize, what we have done, discussed today, in this lecture, we have introduced to you two important types of instructions, data movement instructions, and also data manipulation instructions. With example from 8085 microprocessor. In the next lecture, we shall discuss about the other important types of instructions, as we mentioned in the beginning of the lecture, those other categories like program manipulation instructions, status manipulation instructions, and miscellaneous instructions. So these three will be discussed in the next lecture. Thank you.